Welcome to today's webinar, where you will learn how you can simplify the development of critical medical and industrial application with BlackBerry's QNX and NXP's i.MX 8 application process. Before we start, let me cover a few administrative things. So if you have any technical issue, please write in the chat and we will try to help you. At the end of the webinar, we will have a Q&A with the expert where we will answer your questions live. But you can already start now to type in your question. While we go over the content, feel free to just write it down and we will pick them up at the end and answer them for you. With that, I would like to introduce the speakers of today. So first, from BlackBerry, we have Michael Chalupa. He has over 25 years of experience and is now a field application engineer at BlackBerry. Then we have Robert Thompson from NXP. He's a director edge processing ecosystem, and Toradex is part of that ecosystem. And as you can see there on the bottom left, we are a platinum partner. We worked with Robert for many, many years. And then to myself, my name is Daniel Lang. I'm the chief marketing officer for Toradex. I'm with Toradex for over 16 years, and I'm located here in Switzerland. So today we will first have a short intro. That's what I'm doing. Then we will look at actually a use case of automated external defibrillators, where you can see how NXP, Toradex and BlackBerry work together to create a real product. We will go a little bit about the requirement for that product, so you see what's actually possible. Then we will look closer at the technology stack, and we will start at the hardware at the SoC level, where Robert will talk about the i.MX 8 family. Then we will cover Toradex with the system on module and how that simplifies your hardware design. And then Michael will talk about BlackBerry QNX. And then we will also step you through how you can actually get started. You will see how easy it is, the out-of-the-box experience, and how easy it is to get started with your product development. With that, I would like to hand over to Michael to talk about the case study.
Thanks, Daniel. And hello, everyone. My name is Michael Chalupa, field application engineer with BlackBerry QNX. Happy to be here alongside our partners to talk about how we can help bring your medical devices to life on NXP's i.MX 8 processors. Before we get started to talk about our use case on next generation connected AEDs, I want to bring everyone's attention to the new cybersecurity regulations in the medical device industry. We understand that these new regulations are a disruptor to the industry and are impacting new medical devices trying to go to market. At BlackBerry QNX, there's a saying, there's no safety without security. It's a model well integrated into our organizational culture, which we pride ourselves in when developing our foundational software products and services. As it relates to the FDA, the new cybersecurity mandate draws homage to this motto, as they are now tasked with ensuring the safety, efficacy, and security of medical products. As you are probably aware, the demand on the healthcare industry is growing, and there's some pressure on the device manufacturers to build greater and better products. As a result, these innovations are becoming more connected, using more open source software, and are becoming more susceptible to cybersecurity attacks. Because of this added pressure, the FDA has expanded its scope to include cybersecurity to mitigate against cyber threats. When we talk about cybersecurity regulations, it's best that we start with understanding what was considered, or rather, what security pain points were being addressed. The first being the vulnerability in outdated software. As you know, medical devices have a long life cycle and can be in the field for 10 plus years. As a result, these devices may often use outdated software with potential security vulnerabilities, thus impacting the integrity of the device and its ability to fend off attacks. Another potential vulnerability is to address the insufficient level of authentication and unauthorized access controls. By taking a page from NIST and adopting the zero trust architecture, we can get a better understanding of what this entails. The zero trust architecture is a paradigm shift that challenges the traditional approach of assuming trust within the network. Instead, it emphasizes the need to verify the authenticate every user and device, regardless of their location or network access. This approach helps minimize the risk of unauthorized access and ensures continuous verification of identities and devices. Next is the need to protect against insecure network connections. As medical devices become more and more connected, there are vulnerabilities when there aren't proper protections in place. Network firewalls or adaptive partitioning with a real-time operating system can help manage some of the cybersecurity threats that could help address vulnerabilities in an unsecured network environment. For example, connecting to public Wi-Fi while your insulin pump is tethered to your phone via Bluetooth connection. That's a pretty dangerous type of scenario that we want to prevent. Many devices today do not leverage encryption as well, which is yet another security policy that needs to be addressed. We need to make sure that the data collected in these devices are encrypted when sharing with other devices and back-end systems. The need to improve inadequate device monitoring is yet another issue. Medical devices are an integral part of the healthcare industry. It is important that effective monitoring systems are in place to detect and respond to cybersecurity incidents. This could mean knowing when the device is being attacked and being able to respond by placing the device in a safe mode. Finally, there is concern about supply chain vulnerabilities. With global supply chains, there is a need to validate and authenticate every component in a medical device to ensure against counterfeiting. Where are you getting your hardware? Where are you getting your software? And how are you validating that it's safe and secure? Now that we have a general understanding of cybersecurity considerations, let's talk about the specific medical device, the AED, and why we just spent the past few minutes understanding the new cybersecurity regulations. Before we get into connected aspects of AEDs, let's go over quickly what an automated external defibrillator is. The AED is a device that automatically analyzes the heart's rhythm and provides a shock for those individuals who are experiencing a sudden cardiac arrest. There are primarily two different types of AEDs. The first category is user type. There are AEDs for public access. These devices are designed for those with no training or experience and are found in schools, malls, airports, and other public locations. On the other side of the spectrum are the AEDs that are designed for professional use. EMTs and paramedics who have received training, these devices are frequently found in ambulances or med packs. Now, the second category of AEDs is automation. Semi-automated defibrillators require you to press a button to deliver a shock when warranted. Comparatively, a fully automated defibrillator performs the treatment automatically. Today, we'll focus on public access AEDs that can be both semi and fully automated. AEDs are one of the most important devices in the market. However, it does not go without challenges. Having been available to the public for decades now, there is still the need to educate the public. Studies have shown that the general public is unaware of the AEDs are and how they should be used. As a result, there's been a relative low usage rate. Other triggers for low usage are often associated with people simply not knowing where to find the device. When dealing with cardiac arrest, time is of the essence. Given that people generally don't know what an AED is, those that do don't always know how to use them, which can slow them down or prevent them from using one entirely. In addition to all this, there is also somewhat of a reluctance to use AEDs, fearing that they could do more harm than good, even though they're designed to be safe. Last of all, as we are all human, there's an element of people simply freezing up and not knowing what to do when they see someone going into cardiac arrest. So it's not all doom and gloom. New developments in automated external defibrillators are making their way into the public's hands. As noted, the connected aspect of AEDs is trending and simulating new innovation into not only addressing some of the pain points mentioned, but also providing level of cost savings. In the past, scheduled maintenance of AEDs is laborious and costly. Not only do you need to send an inspector occasionally to inspect and replace the batteries and pads, but sometimes people forget the AED's pads are for one-time use only, rendering the AED ineffective if it was put back. However, with the connected AED, maintenance is automated and can be verified remotely. It can detect if an AED was used, if the battery needs replacing, or even provide location coordinates if it's been misplaced. Other possible use cases include leveraging artificial intelligence or machine learning for patient diagnostics. New sensor technologies are making their way into the market. It is enabling opportunities to collect new data points that could potentially estimate a patient's age based on the speed of the heart rate with a wireless RF sensor. We're using visible thermal cameras and gender recognition software to detect the gender of the patient. There are a number of new technologies available that could change the dynamic of AEDs. Innovations that could disrupt the healthcare industry and find new solutions that are optimized to improve emergency care and services. For example, using the data input to train a model to optimize defibrillation based on patient age, gender, and real-time conditions. Another emerging use case is to use the device to provide instructional support to a community first responder. Based on sensory information, the AED can detect the patient's health and what is needed to help. It can provide instructional information both verbally and through graphics cues on how to correct the positioning of the AED pad or advising on how the community first responders should be conducting CPR. These are just some of the use case examples as to what a connected AED can do with the power of the cloud and edge computing. It is definitely an exciting time to be in the IoT market. With all the new advancements in technology, especially surrounding machine learning and artificial intelligence, there are a lot of new tools that can be leveraged to improve medical devices. To ensure that these devices can meet these expectations, today's session outlines the products we have that will ensure your next AEDs are able to perform while ensuring that they are safely certified and securely protected from malicious attacks.
Okay, good. Thanks a lot, Michael, to show us what's possible with QNX, NXP, and Toradex. With that, we would dive into the tech stack and we start with the SoC. And for that, I'd like to hand over to Robert.
Thanks, Daniel. To start off with, to introduce NXP or remind you of what we're about. NXP is focused on delivering secure connected connections for a smarter world, where we play a number across a number of different markets. So really, what does that mean in terms of secure connections for a smarter world? Well, if we look at the markets we play in by going to the next slide, as you can see, we play across a number of different markets from automotive, mobile, communications infrastructure, but we're going to focus on industrial and IoT. But across all these markets, what they need right now is a range of high-performance application processors that are connected to a range of clouds, be both remote and local, through a secure connection. Therefore, although we play in many different diverse markets, the core elements of what is needed to be successful are common across all these different markets. So let's deep dive now into what we mean by industrial and IoT by going to the next slide. So the focus segments within the industrial and IoT markets are factory and process automation, building and energy, transportation mobility, and for today's discussion, healthcare. Now, all of these segments are extremely broad and require a wide range of microcontrollers to application processors. NXP has the widest range of ARM products in the market today, ranging from very low power M0 plus microcontrollers, which can run on a coin cell battery for months, if not years, up to very high-end network processors, enabling base stations in the transition to 5G technology. But all of them are based on a wide range of i.MX application processors, which you can see on the next slide. If we look at the range of application processors, there are many parts from the many different usage models which we serve with our range of products. However, what is common about the i.MX 6, the i.MX 8, and the i.MX 9, which was recently announced, is that we come out with a family of products, not a point product, looking to leverage the same software and the same hardware in terms of pin-to-pin compatibility, if possible. The i.MX 6, which was first launched in 2012, will continue to ship until 2035. The i.MX 8, which were first launched in 2016, also have a long life cycle, which we'll touch on later on as a key value proposition. In terms of the AED market, we're really going to focus on the i.MX 8 family today, which ranges from the extremely powerful i.MX 8 Quad Max down to the 8N family, which is looking at multimedia applications. So if we go to the next slide, we can really focus in three versions of the i.MX 8, which are applicable to work with QNX, Toradex, and the AED market. If we start off with the i.MX 8 Quad Max, we are really looking at the most powerful i.MX 8 application processor with up to 6 cores running at over 1.6 gigahertz, advanced 3D graphics, and the most powerful i.MX application processor. In comparison, the i.MX 8X is based on the more power efficient A35 core, which combined with inline error correction code on the DDR3L memory interface, makes it suitable to achieve the industrial SIL3 safety level by using a safety level RTOS on the A core, such as the QNX Neutrino. And then the 8M Plus combines the advanced computing and safety of the 8 Quad Max and the 8X with the addition of an integrated neural processing unit and the image signal processor to fully enable machine learning at the edge. However, whichever one of our i.MX application processors you choose to base on your design, you can be guaranteed of the same core values. And if we go to the next slide, we can see what those are. So the first is that all of the parts that I showed on the previous two slides are in the market for at least 15 years. And as I mentioned with the i.MX 6, that has been extended to 2035. And the i.MX 8 will be extended again as soon as we get close to the current end of life date, as we work closely with the foundries to make sure we have long-term availability. We have a formal program where we list the end of life and life cycles of the different parts. In terms of scalability, as I mentioned, we have many parts, but what we try and do is reduce that complexity by maintaining pin-to-pin compatibility where possible. Therefore, if you start the design with one part and need to move to another feature set, you can do that without completely redesigning your board. And we run the same BSPs across the entire portfolio. We're able to do this by the fact that we reuse as much IP as possible. And now we are moving towards internally developing that IP that will allow us to maintain that compatibility across many parts. And then finally, in terms of enablement, when we talk about security, which Michael started talking off about, we really look at implementing the same security across the entire portfolio. Therefore, if you look at your security architecture and you're using different parts from our portfolio, you can make sure that you implement the same security and not having to re-architect your security and your safety implementation for the different products based on our different parts. We also then make sure that we realize when it comes to the medical market and different usage models and different end products such as AEDs, we work very closely with the industry leaders, such as you're seeing on this call today, QNX and Toradex, to make sure that the base enablement we provide through application processes are leveraged by industry leaders to develop industry-leading end products and devices for the many different usage models we look at. And with that, I will turn it back over to Daniel.
Thanks so much, Robert. Before we dive in and show you how Toradex makes it even easier to use the NXP i.MX processor, also very brief, what's Toradex, what we are doing, in case you don't know yet. So our main goal is really make embedded computing easy. And this here is a very good example. We're taking the SoCs from NXP, we're working with QNX, bringing everything together. So make it easy for you to get access to the latest technology, but make it a little bit easier so you can be on the market faster. How we do that is mostly with reliable ARM system on modules, which I will show you later. We also have a Linux IoT platform. Today the focus is QNX, but if you want to work on Linux, we can also help you there. We believe we can deliver to you the lowest cost of ownership. And that doesn't mean just the cost of the system on module. That means the cost of your whole project with the development resources you need, the time you can be on the market, but also the maintenance over the lifetime of the product. If you put that all together, we feel we can really deliver the lowest cost of ownership. We are very proud of our industry-leading support. So as you can see here on the right side, we have offices all over the world. We have local warehouses, we have local FOEs. We have very extensive online resources with over 800 articles. We have a very active community. And then, of course, you also have webinars and blogs as you are now experiencing on live. For our markets, very similar than what you just saw from Robert. So I don't go over that. Of course, today the focus on healthcare and industrial automation. Our customers have typical volumes of a few hundreds to a few 10,000 pieces per project per year. That's kind of where our sweet spot is. Our hardware portfolio is three families of system on modules, and they're pin compatible within the family. So what Robert showed you there, that some of the chips are pin compatible, we now even extend that more. So you can upgrade from an i.MX6 ULL to an i.MX6 to an i.MX7 to an i.MX8, and you only need to exchange the module. Many of these modules also support a QNX out of the box, mostly the i.MX8, which is the focus for today, but we also have an i.MX6. So if you already have, for example, Colibri i.MX6 with QNX, you could upgrade your QNX and even the hardware on i.MX8 if you would like to do that. Why a system module, or why should I not just use the SoC, Robert, just showed you, and when does it maybe make sense to use a system on module? So one big concept is really that we encapsulate the complexity. So if you use an i.MX8, you have to route DDR memory, you have to deal with the power management, power sequencing. There are small components, PHY, flash, maybe even wireless. And we really bring that all together so you can use almost the whole computer and just focus your attention on what's the differentiation in your product. We really lower time to market because you already have a starting point that's tested, you know, that works. Much lower risk, much faster time to market. Supply chain streamlining was a really, really big topic over COVID. I'm sure everybody heard about the tightness in the supply chains. Toradex could really help the customer. The customer didn't have to deal with hundreds of components on the SOM, they just had to buy one SOM. Also, as we are one of the platinum partners from NXP, we got we got nice chips and people could still buy. So we saw a lot of people moving from design-ins to SOMs because of the supply chain. simplified maintenance. So if anything goes end of life, let's say a RAM module goes end of life, we will replace that, we'll test that, make sure it works before we do that. Of course, when we design a product, we are selecting products who have a very long lifetime, such as Robert just showed, NXP 10 to 15 year lifetime on that. Also, you gain a lot of scalability and upgradability. Also, as mentioned, you can now move from an i.MX 7 to an 8 or, you know, whatever you want. You're also flexible and you may have different products in different performance ranges. You can do that very, very easily. And you profit from the economy of scale. So because we buy these products in very, very high volume. So if you only need a few thousand, normally we can give you some of these savings, and it's cheaper also because the complexity is on the module. You maybe get away with maybe 4-layer, 6-layer board instead of maybe a 12-layer board, also really helping with cost. Ideally, solutions before, it's from a few hundred to a few 10,000. If you have lower volumes, then off-the-shelf carrier boards, more single board computers, is a good solution. I will show you a little bit later. Or if you really go higher, then designing is good. And it's also something Toradex can help you, where you then really design everything on one board. Here, some of the single board computers carrier, which take our modules. So you can see here a lot of partners, and that's just a small selection. There are much more. So if you maybe don't want to design everything yourself, you can just take one of these boards and you can plug in some with QNX on there. And basically get started. So there we have some AI, we have some HMIs, a ruggedized computer, or more like single board gateway type of things. So quite a choice. And most of them are all of the Toradex carrier board, they also reference design, so you can start. Most of our customers design on carrier board or work with our partner to design that. And for that, we have a lot of resources. You can see all our designs are available in Altium Designer, so you can start there, delete it. We have pinning tools, so we call a pinout designer, which helps you deciding which pin you want to use, multiplexing. We have a lot of webinars focusing on hardware design, about EMI backfeeding, USB-C, and so on. And you can see there, Peter, one of our lead engineers, his webinars are very popular. And I can tell you many of these resources here I show you, even if you don't use a Toradex board, take a look. There's a lot of tips and hints, and we get a lot of very good feedback from even people who do complete different designs. Also, I like to give a shout out to two of our partners, Triadime and ICS. This is a partner who can help you customize QNX even more and can help you with integration. Triadime, Swiss company, but they also serve outside of Switzerland, and ICS located in the US. So we have a partner network, and we won many projects with these two companies together. So they're really good partner also for your project. With that, let me hand back to Michael, and he will talk a little bit more about QNX, and then you will also really see hands-on how you can get started and write your first program.
Thanks, Daniel. Getting started with QNX, understanding your project needs. Are you looking for one or more of the following? BlackBerry QNX is built on a foundation of trust. Trust with our clients, trust with our partners, and trust at the heart of our products. We are able to establish decades-long reputation for being a preferred operating system of choice for mission life and safety critical systems. Our success is driven by five pillars: safety, security, reliability, scalability, and performance. If you're building a device that has automated, connected, or complex systems and require a combination of these benefits, QNX can help. Throughout the development of your product lifecycle, QNX is able to support all aspects of your needs. Design leveraging QNX start by using the performance and reliability of our RTOS and hypervisor. Layered on top is the safety certification to ensure you're able to develop safety critical or mixed criticality systems that meet the foundational standards of the medical industry. If cybersecurity is a priority, We also offer multiple products and services to address your needs, in addition to the fact that we have a microkernel secured architecture. No matter where you are in the development cycle, we have a multitude of products and services to ensure your setup for success. At this time, I'd like to show how easy it is to get started with QNX 7.1 and our development environment and walk through the processes of getting an evaluation, applying for that evaluation, and getting the approval through the system. On this, you'll see a link that shows you how to create your MyQNX account. Once you have your MyQNX account created, you can then apply for the evaluation at the link shown here. And once the evaluation is approved, you'll actually get an email telling you with the license that you're looking for, and you'll be able to download what we call our QNX Software Center. Now, the QNX Software Center is our safe and secure, highly cyber secure way of getting information from QNX, getting all of our tools, getting all of our packages, all of our updates. You, once you have installed QNX Software Center, will go through the process of installing all of our components and all of our packages via that tool. We also recommend that you download some of these additional documents for your understanding and ability to understand how to work with our systems. The MyQNX License Manager and the user guide for the Software Center is very important in the beginning. Software Center tool tech notes tell you about what the Software Center can do, and deploying QNX products in large organizations is once you've evaluated our product, read that so that you understand how you can install the product and deploy it to large organizations that are using the tools and are developing a program with that. Now, when you have the QNX Software Center installed, it's gonna look like this. So here on the right-hand side, you'll see the Welcome to the QNX Software Center application. Each one of these components, the add installation, install patch sets, all those are key and important components that you need to understand. But when you first start off with it, we want you to go in, select the license manager keys, and activate your license. Once you've activated your license, the next step is to start making installations. And for most users that are doing this for the first time, we recommend that you install the Momentix IDE first. So by going in and pressing on the add installation, it'll walk you through and allow you to download the Momentix 7.1 IDE. Once you've completed that, you're going to go back to add installation, and now you're going to actually install the QNX Software Development Platform 7.1, which is the actual compiler and all the tools that go along with that, so that you can create your applications and install a board support package and start using the product as it was intended. Now, once you have installed your software development platform image, the next thing to do is to manage the installation. And by managing the installation, what I mean is there are two or three important things that you need to do. The first thing that you want to do is to make sure that you look through and see what's available. So on this manage installation component in the Software Development Center, you're going to see five tabs. You're going to see an update tab, you're going to see an available tab, an install tab, an all tab, and an advanced tab. By reading the documentation, you'll learn more about it, but in general, you usually start with the available tab, look to see what is available there, and as you see here, you're going to see that there's a Toradex, a Palace, i.MX, 8QM, Xora board support package. That's the thing that we want you to install. So you need to make sure that you select that and you add that by going through and installing it into your system. Once you have your BSP installed, you're going to go and look at starting your Momentix IDE. By starting your Momentix IDE, you're going to create a workspace. You can make the workspace located in the default location, or you can make it go to other locations where you're looking for. But from getting the system set up, creating your workspace, you launch Momentix, and what will happen is you'll end up looking at something like this. You're going to have an IDE that comes in front of you. And at this point in time, you're going to start Momentix, and Momentix is our integrated development environment. And as you can see, I've preloaded it with two components. The first thing is I preloaded it with the Apalis board support package for the i.MX 8QM. In here, you see the actual file structure for the board support package. You see binary folders, you see an images folder, you have the install folder, pre-built components, as well as source. With this, you'll create this BSP, you'll configure it to have the components that you're looking for, you'll create a binary image that you can load onto a device such as an SD card, a micro card, or even flash it into your eMMC memory or HDD memory, and boot the system and run QNX on the hardware. The second part thing that I did is I created a simple hello world, and you can do that by simply saying file, new, QNX project, and select the QNX legacy recursive make project. Subsequent pop-ups will come up, you'll fill in the information, and as you see in this case, I created two versions of the hello world, one for Arch 64, which is an ARM v8 architecture, and also for the x86-64. The unique part here is it shows you that you can build images for different architectures at the same time and end up getting both debug versions or non-debug versions of that application. Now, another thing that's part of the relationship that we have with Toradex is Toradex has a product called the Toradex Easy Installer. It's available in the BSP that I showed you on the previous page. It's located in that images folder, and all you have to do is simply unzip the file, the zip file that's located in that images folder, and it'll create an installer folder in the system. You then copy that installer folder into your USB or SD micro device, insert that device into your Apalis Xora evaluation module, and then simply power on the Apalis target system. And here's where we're going to see some interesting stuff that's going to be demoed for you shortly. Now I'm going to hand this over to Bruno Mello from Toradex, who will now provide an interactive work session with Momentix and the Apalis target system.
Thanks, Michael. Here I have an Apalis module with the Xora carrier board with QNX installed. Just as you can see in the picture, it is connected directly to the computer via a serial port and through the same network as my development computer is on. Now, I will show you how easy it is to run a simple Hello World application and get started with QNX on Toradex modules. Here I have Momentix open. First, we need to open a serial connection to the board and tell it to boot from the eMMC. To do that, we just go here and open a terminal. COM6 is the only one available, but if you have more devices connected, you may need to select another one. And here we have a terminal open. We can just press enter, and then we see the different options for booting. As QNX is installed on the system, we can just press E, so it boots from eMMC. Now that it's booted, we just need to run ifconfig to see what is the board's IP. And in this case, it is 10.22.1.140. We can just copy that and add a new target. It will be a QNX target. And then finish. Now we have our target. With the target configured, we can move forward and create a project. We can do that by just right-clicking here on the Project Explorer and creating a new QNX project. We want to create a QNX executable. So we just have to put a project name, which will be Hello QNX, and set the appropriate architecture for the module. We just click Finish, and then our project is configured. To run it, we can do it with just one click. This will just run the project, and if we also want to run it in debug mode, we simply add a breakpoint, change it to debug mode, and run it. Then it will load up everything that you need to debug your project and stop at the breakpoint. If we just press continue, it will output Hello World as expected. All right. Thank you for your attention. Now, moving on to the Q&A.
Thanks, Bruno, a lot for the live presentation here, or you know, stepping us through. Now we would be at the Q&A. And also, let me share my camera so you can actually see me here. So if you join later, I will tell you how that works. So there is a question in the chat. So you can type your questions in there and we will answer it live. So please, if you have any questions there, place it there and we will answer it. So let me start here with the first one. Will QNX 8 be supported? Maybe I can take that. At the moment, we have the QNX 7.1, as you could see, but we are in talk with BlackBerry to also bring QNX 8 to the i.MX 8. So stay tuned, there will be news. Is QNX the only way to get hard real-time on an i.MX 8? Maybe also can comment on that, and then Michael, maybe you can add a little bit. So there, it's a very good way to do that, especially if you need high performance combined with real time. I would say it's the best one. If you can offload and separate the high performance part from the low latency or real time part, then there is also other ways. There is, for example, a microcontroller integrated in all the i.MX 8. Some are Cortex M7, some are Cortex M4. And some of our customers, they run bare metal or a very small microcontroller real-time operating system on that to have on a subsystem real-time capabilities. Michael, I don't know if you may want to add, there is also a hypervisor solutions maybe which could help people to get real-time on part of the system and but still maybe have a Linux or Android running somewhere else.
Right. So with respect to having an RTOS running on an i.MX 8, QNX obviously is one of the proprietary real-time operating systems that are available. As Daniel mentioned, we have a hypervisor. So our hypervisor solution makes the system allow you to create guests. Your guests can be Linux and or Android guests. So you have many different options. But we feel that QNX's real-time capabilities and our high performance for our high compute operating system is the best way for you guys to go forward on an i.MX 8.
Good. Then here a question. Are Toradex SOMs pin compatible to SOMs from other companies as well? So we don't have the SMARC or OSM models you may hear. However, our standard is open. And for example, on the Colibri module, I do know there are third-party companies who have modules which are basically pin compatible. Our pinout is totally open, so there is possible to do even a module yourself. So that's that. But we are not, if you're asking for SMARC or OSM, that's not what we do. We heavily optimize the modules for these use cases. You could see and enhance that that pin out. Then what else do we have? Can I use common GUI libraries like Qt? Maybe I also talk from my side and Michael can add it. So from Toradex side, I'm aware that many of our customers use Qt and Crank. And both Qt and Crank are also in our partner network. So we work very close with them together. And I think that's a popular GUI choice I see for QNX. I don't know if there are more and other popular ones, Mike.
Yeah, so there are other popular GUIs that can be supported, but Qt and Crank are the most popular that we've seen to date. So again, thanks, Daniel. It's true that you can use those binaries and those modules on QNX.
Okay. Then, how does NXP support the ASIL D certification on the i.MX 8X? So maybe I highlight a little bit what Robert said. Robert couldn't join, so I will cover that, and Michael, and I think mostly it's actually about QNX, but IMX, some of the IMX 8, like the IMX 8X, they have ECC protection on some of the cache and RAM, which simplifies the certification process. There is also microcontroller, as I mentioned before, on the real-time part, they can be used to monitor the rest of the system and so help to get your system certified. But I think Michael and BlackBerry have much more experience with safety certification.
Right. So QNX is a safety certified operating system as well. So you have your standard QNX 7.1, but you also have QNX OS for safety 2.2. And we've gone through the certification of our product on i.MX 8. We've worked closely with NXP and with partners like Toradex to make sure that our system goes through the safety cases, make sure that we go through and present that information to Rhineland, which is our certification house. And based on the process that we go through and the procedures that we have internally, we get a certificate, we provide you a hazard and risk analysis, and a bunch of other documentation for you to use so that you can get your product to SIL 3 certification quickly. And of course, we work closely with you when you're developing with us to make sure that any of the hardware capabilities that are available from NXP to have a secure boot or any type of TPM capabilities and trust zones, that they are integrated into the solution with QNX.
Good. Thanks a lot, Michael. Is it possible to use QNX in a deterministic critical application? I'll let you answer.
Of course, we are a deterministic operating system. So basically, all of our real-time capabilities are deterministic. You can set those processes up. You can set the environment so that you are getting a deterministic real-time response to your applications.
You mentioned that Altium ECAD files are available. Are the SOMS Altium ECAD schematics and BCB files available for us or only daughterboard? So typically the daughterboard, so where you plug it in, because typically that's the only thing you need to customize. If you need customized SOMS, we offer called BTO, build to order. So if you need anything special on it or you want to save cost, you can talk with us. We also help our customer to really scale up. So as described, SOMs are typically very good from a few hundred to a few 10,000. If you need more, a design-in can make sense. And that's really when you also can get access to the schematics of the board, and we help you in the design-in. So that's possible. It's not typically, but there is possible. There is other, sometimes there needs to be reviews or other things. So we can really help with that. But typically what you can find on our website and just download, that's our CAD files and BOMs and so on from the daughter board or carrier boards, how we call them. Good. Let me see here. When will i.MX 8 and plus be supported? So we are working with that. I think it's in testing. Mike, I think it's not online yet, but it should come up any day, right?
Yes, correct. We are in testing and we're getting ready to release that. Obviously, we want to make sure that when we release it, it is a good out-of-box experience. So as soon as it's available, we'll make it an announcement on our website.
Okay. If Ixora carrier is used for the application with the QNX 7.1 BSP, any plans on reeling a validated BSP? Don't 100% understand, but maybe I answer it and then you can ask again. So we do have this BSP, but they're typically evaluation. There's the starting point, and Michael, correct me if see it a little bit different, but they are like the starting point. And many time you need additional customization, maybe another display, or you have additional peripheral, or you want to change something. So they're really thought as a kickstarting point to get you to market super fast with much lower cost, because you don't need to do all of that, and with much lower risk. But Michael, I don't know if you have to add anything to that one.
No, Daniel, I think you're correct. Most of our board support packages that we work with, both our partners and those that we have on our board support directory, are there for a starting point. And basically, they're released with a stable mode, and you can use them and make many modifications or changes. And if necessary, you can come to either Toradex or QNX to have us do additional services for you if there's custom drivers that you need done for your design.
And even this you know, starting points, they're quite well tested. That's what we are doing currently with the M Plus. Good. Let's see here if there's any more. If I skip down. Good. Okay, I think we have most. So give you a few seconds more. So if you have any more questions, please drop them. And of course, we would be very happy to talk on a one-on-one with you about your next project and see how we can accelerate that and get it to market. If you have more questions about if QNX is a fit or not, we can go together. As we see, we are all partners, so we can do three-way calls, and you know, Toradex and QNX can, you know, help you here together, so you have the best mix of hardware and software for your next product. Good. I think I don't see any news coming in, so I wish you all a great day and a nice weekend. Thanks so much, and have a great day.
Have a great weekend, everyone. Bye.
Bye-bye.